Hello everyone, it's me again, Geisha Deidre, back with another video, so thank you for tuning in. Today, I bring you another interesting topic, the Japanese Mafia, also known as the Yakuza. Admittedly, I didn't know much about the Yakuza going in, but I've learned a lot along the way and I'd like to share my findings with you guys. So if you're interested in learning more about Japanese gangsters, stay tuned and let's learn something together. For those of you who don't know, the Yakuza are basically a group of criminals that perform organized crime all around Japan, and they're known by many names. The Yakuza are also known as Gokudo, which translates to the extreme path, which is very fitting given their lifestyle. They are also referred to as Boryokudan by the Japanese police, which basically translates to violent group. However, the Yakuza refer to themselves as Ninkyo Dantai, which means chivalrous organization. I know, you're probably thinking chivalrous is one of the last words you would use to describe mafia that commit crime on a regular basis. But according to them, they're the true heroes of the story. The Yakuza see themselves as servants of justice, stepping in whenever the government falls short. Not to say I'm defending what they do, but there's definitely a reason behind all of the questionable things they've done. Now that we know who they are and what they're all about, let's look into how they got started in the first place. Let's investigate their origin story. It is unknown exactly when the Yakuza came to be, but they are said to have arisen around the middle of the Edo period. There were two main groups that came together to form the Yakuza. The first being Tekiya, who were a group of thieves that resold stolen goods, and the second was Bakuto, a group of high-stakes gamblers. Both halves of the Yakuza's origins can be seen in the way that they operate today. The Yakuza hierarchy comes from the structure of the Tekiya side. The leaders, or the boss, was called the Oyabun, which basically means parental half. They were in charge of guiding and protecting their gang members. The gang members themselves were called Kobun, which translates to child half. They were expected to do their job and do it well. Like a good boy. But because of this familial nature between the Yakuza, it became a home for society's misfits and delinquents, people who never really belonged. The Yakuza welcomed them with open arms and created a brotherhood, a true family. This is one of the reasons why loyalty is valued so highly in the Yakuza, and the price is heavy if you are to disobey or betray. Also, the area in Japan with the most Yakuza is Kyushu. It's the island in pink. Now, let's get into the Yakuza's appearance. The Yakuza are very distinct, however, we can break up their appearance into multiple parts. The biggest and most obvious physical characteristic is their tattoos. Tattoos were seen as a literal symbol of their commitment and dedication to the organization. In fact, tattooing was illegal in Japan at a point in time, and getting oneself permanently tattooed was a symbol that one was not only courageous, but willing to accept their outlaw status for life. Because the Yakuza are businessmen, they make their tattoos in a way that they're able to be concealed under a standard suit and tie, which is why they have a particular design, leaving some skin untattooed around the sternum area. Yakuza are often described as being male, wearing sharp business suits and having their hair slicked back with gel. Although the Yakuza are criminals, they are said to be one of the most sophisticated and wealthiest criminal organizations. I guess it helps to have a squeaky clean appearance and to clean up nice. Next, let's look into the Yakuza's culture. Most of the Yakuza's code of conduct is based on the idea of loyalty, dedication, commitment, and obedience. As some Yakuza members are disowned by their family, or just don't have family to start with, the gang acts as a surrogate family where members can find brother and father figures that they don't have in their personal lives. Like family, the Yakuza see themselves as being bonded by blood, and there's a heavy price to pay if you're to defy the family. Remember, devotion and keeping your promises is a paramount part of being a Yakuza. So what happens when you break your promises? It's simple, really. You get your fingers cut off. Yep, you heard right. Breaking your pinky promise might mean losing that pinky. This is a ritual inherited from the Bakuto side, or the gambling side of Yakuza's history. It's called yubitsume, or finger shortening. Yubitsume is a way to show extreme remorse for someone's wrongdoings, and this actually isn't the only place I've heard of this. The Japanese have their own pinky promise song, which is often sung by school-aged children. Yubikiri genman, uso tsuitara hari senbon nomasu, yubikitta. The majority of Japanese people grow up listening to this song, so many know it by heart. So I think it goes to show that this is a consequence of lying, even when it's just said as a joke. And you know, the Yakuza are about that action, so I wouldn't put it past them to actually tell you to do it. Other than that, the Yakuza have a totem pole kind of hierarchy system that I lightly explained earlier. It's a lot more intricate than what I said, and you can see a little diagram here. Yeah. I'll just leave this here. Okay, let's move on to the fun stuff. Pop culture! Pop culture! Let's talk about pop culture. The Yakuza have been featured countless times in books, manga, anime, TV shows, and movies. Here are some that you may know. For those of you with Netflix, here are two shows for you to check out. The first is actually brand new. It's called Goku Shufudo, or The Way of the House Husband. The story follows an ex-Yakuza boss named Tatsu, who stays at home and helps support his wife as she goes to her job. What a great husband. The second is Backstreet Girls, Goku Dolls. The story follows three Yakuza underlings who mess up big time and basically have to have a sex reassignment surgery and then become idols to pay off their immense debt. Yeah. There's a show about that. Let's continue on to our very last section, legacy. Let's talk about the present and future of the Yakuza. These days, it's technically not illegal to be a member of the Yakuza. Although there is legislation in place that prevents the Yakuza from causing too much harm, they are a legitimate organization in the eyes of the law, and the government tries to keep their distance from the Yakuza, and vice versa. They just want to stay out of each other's way, and I totally understand. The Yakuza aren't seen as a totally negative influence on Japan. Although the Yakuza are infamous in Japan for committing crime, they are known for other more philanthropic efforts, especially with the natural disasters that have happened in Japan over the past 20 years or so. A fellow YouTuber, Nobita from Japan, did an interview with an ex-Yakuza member named Yuyama. I want to share the part of the interview that stuck out the most to me. This is what really changed my image of the Yakuza for the better. Have a look for yourselves.
これはね、別に背景っていう背景は別にないんですよ。もともとその、ヤクザっていうのは、強き欲、自力、弱くを助けるというふうな部分から始まってるんですね。要は、ヤクザイコール人狂道っていうんですけど、昔の言葉で言うと。要は、本当にこう困ってる人を助けるっていうのが、ヤクザの生き方、スタイルなんですよ。僕もそれこそ参加させてもらったんですけど、東日本大震災。いても立ってもいられなくて、とにかく何かこうしてやりたいって。 いう感じで、もう僕の若手も全部連れて、で、詰めるだけの支援物資を全部詰め込んで、2週間ぐらいいたのかな、宮城県に。まあ今回ね、熊本の人吉市、水害がね、すごくあってて、で、もともとその、ゆかりがあった地なんで、もうできることをとにかくしようっていうことで、ボランティア活動なんかも、 すごくさせていただいています。まあ背景という背景に関しては、これは例えば自分の利益があるのかないのかというのは何もないです。お金に関しては全部抜けていくだけだし、でもね、困ってる人がいたら助けてあげたいなっていうそのただの気持ちです。And
on that positive note, let's draw this video to a close. Thank you so much for tuning in. I'm glad that you are here and I hope that you learned something. If you like this video, then like it so I can see that you do. And if you want to see more, hit subscribe and become part of the YouTube fam. Well, I hope that you have a great day or a great night, and I'll see you in the next one. Bye!